I thank you, Pastor Bob, for allowing me to preach in this pulpit, your pulpit, and I'm honored. And Miss Christy, thank you for just your spirit of just always smiling when you don't feel like it. And you truly need to pray, especially in the days that we're living. It's hard to pastor. Come on, somebody. It's easy for me now to pastor because I've told my people just a month ago that I've ran out of diapers. I'm not changing no more. And there's times that we all have to grow up. Come on, somebody. I know some of you are already mad, but I need some help when I preach. We can clap and dance and shout and raise our hands for the singers, but the preachers need a little bit too. Come on, somebody. I'm just saying. And you know what is so neat? You know what is so neat about this very moment right now? And let me go ahead and get this out of the way. I am truly a crybaby. I cry, and I don't work up my tears. I just cry. My mama said if my eyes leaked, my head wouldn't swell. But anyway, I took after my dad. But right now, this very moment, at 10 after 11, in my family, at this very moment, there are three generations preaching in three different states. My dad, that's been in the ministry for 56 years, is preaching in Florida. As my absence from the covering church, my son, oldest son, is preaching for his daddy, and I'm here in Virginia preaching in front of you. And but that's something. That's just a memory for us. We have a daughter, Jasmine, 24, Jockton, 23, and our bonus baby, Joshua, 14. And so anyway, eight and a half years later, but we have a beautiful family inside and out. And if you're a parent and your child is out in left field, don't stop praying. Because I had a daughter and a son out in left field, but God still brings prodigals home and changes their life. Amen. And I want you to take the Word of God just for the next few minutes and turn to Ephesians chapter 4, Ephesians chapter 4, beginning with verse 21. And I really, truly prayed and was in fast of what to deliver to you today. I just don't want to get a candy sermon or something good, but what I believe in my spirit that you need. I believe that in our entire nation, that the church needs to quit saying we need revival. Let's just have revival. We're always saying the nation needs it. And believe me, the nation needs it. But the average church needs it. I said the average church needs, again, a touch of the Holy Ghost. We just need to get ghosted. And that is the reason I wrote my first book, The Divorced Bride, because there's a separation in the church. I pastor a diverse congregation. We literally have 50% African Americans and 50%, amen, I got one coming, hey, can I get two? And 50% white, and they help me preach. And I'm telling you, and we have purple hair, we have piercings, we have tattoos, we have attorney, we have a ditch digger. But we all are in a unified spirit. Come on, somebody. And I know that maybe this is my only time preaching, because y'all may not have me back, so this is my one shot. And y'all took your time at first. I'm going to take my time. Amen? And as I told the men yesterday, that we don't put up with junk no more. Come on, somebody. Some of you are going to get mad. If you're not smiling, you're the very one I'm talking about. We just don't put up with religious spirits anymore. And the church house should be a safe place where that hurt mama and that down and out daddy and that single mom that's just tired and weary, that they don't want to come into more drama or more. They need to come to the house of God to receive worship and the word. Mm. Some of the meanest folk I know are church folk. I'll come back and preach on that later. But I'm excited to be here. I really am. And I just want to speak to you. I'm not a long-winded preacher. But if you'll smile, I may shorten it up just a little bit more. Look at your neighbor and say, I am ready for the word. Ephesians chapter 4, beginning with verse 21, it says, if indeed you have heard him and have been taught in him, just as the truth is in Jesus, that in reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old man, you lay aside, meaning put off, the old man, which is being corrupted according with the lust of deceit, and you be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and you put on the new man, new self, which is according to God, or the likeness of God, that has been created in righteousness and holiness of truth. Therefore, laying aside lying, speak truth, each one of you with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down upon your wrath or anger. And do not give the devil an opportunity, and let him who still no more. But rather let him labor, performing with his own hands what is good, in order that we may have something to share with him who has need. Let no corrupt or unwholesome word proceed out of your mouth, but only such a word as is good for edification according to the need for the moment, that it may give grace to all those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. And be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ has forgiven you. I did not get this one verse to you, but it's right there the next door in chapter 5, one verse, verse 8. It reads, for you were formerly darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. So I want to speak just for the next few minutes on this subject. What happens when Christ changes your life? What happens when Christ changes your life? I'm not talking about a church service. I'm not talking about a pastor. I'm not talking about your mama. Don't get mad. Don't charge the pulpit. But I'm talking about what happened, or what happens when Jesus Christ takes up residence in your life. What should happen to every man and every woman? There are four simple truths this morning that I want to release. Because the word said, as I just read, if you have received the truth, because listen to me, once you understand the truth, you are truly set free. So if you understand Jesus, that is the light, that is the truth, that is Jesus, will set you free, and you and I, watch, should speak, listen, see, walk differently. So what happens when Christ changes your life? Number one, there is a change. My God, my God. I said there is a change. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, I'm about to have a spell for some reason right now. I'm telling you, my God, there's freedom in the house. 2 Corinthians 5, 17, therefore, if any man, person, be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. So when you and I If you're sitting in this house this morning and you remember if it was during a revival service in this house or like me on Interstate 85 in Greenville, South Carolina, when I pulled over and was led to Jesus, if you truly understand that you repented genuinely of your sins and you pleaded the blood of Jesus and Jesus Christ came into your heart, there should have been a change in your life. That's kind of like if Becky and I went out and bought a pig. Where I'm from, it's called a hog. From some of you smart people, it's called swine. But if we went and bought a hog and we took it back home, and I yelled at my kids to come help dad and mom, and we put that hog or pig or swine, make everybody happy, in the bathtub, and we washed that hog off, cleaned it up, took it out, dried it off, put a ribbon around its neck, put baby powder all over it. Jasmine painted the toenails, and man, it was so, so nice. Even smelled good. But then we lead that pig back to the front door, and we open the front door. Where will that pig go back to? The mud. Why is that? Because it's the nature of the pig. Good God. When a genuine child of God falls down in the mud, in that clay, it is not a genuine, true salvation child of God to stay down in the mud. That's not our nature. It's not our nature when we fall in the mud. We get up out of it. So what I'm saying is, when Christ changes your life, there is a change. Now, this is so funny, whether you get mad or not, I really can't see, so if you're not smiling or whatever, I can't see you. But anyway, I'm doing an attitude series on Wednesday nights, because attitudes will kill your walk. It's all how you see things. That's truth. So the thing is, even when you become born again, there is a change in your attitude. Well, y'all free over here. They get a little quiet over this section. I'm going to move over here. But the attitude is changed. See, you show me your attitude. Matter of fact, attitude determines your altitude. I have a family member in Florida that it doesn't matter. When we lived in Florida, when we would go over there to eat, they would call. And we would pull up, it'd be me, Becky, Jasmine, Jockton, and Joshua, and it was like we were just a little ducklings just walking up there, because one of my family members, it doesn't matter if there's not a cloud in the sky. It doesn't matter if there's not, you can't even see a cloud. This particular person will look far enough to find a cloud, and I can say, boy, today is beautiful. She's like, nope. You see that cloud up there? Always negative. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Some of you sitting right beside your family member right now going, stay there, preacher, because they're right here. They're right here. I know what you're talking. I live in the real world. But there has to be a change in our life, in our walk, in our talk, even in our attitude. I know what some of you are saying. You say, well, Pastor Jeff, I enjoyed your wife and I'm enjoying you now, but you, I guess you just think you're perfect. No, close, but no. We all have bad days. We all have bad days. But I told the men yesterday, misery is optional. You don't have to stay miserable. See, when Jesus Christ changes your life, there is a change. Number two, what happens when Christ changes your life? There is a convincing attitude. I said there is a convincing attitude. The Apostle Paul writes in Acts chapter 9, beginning with verse 20. Acts chapter 9, beginning with verse 20. Watch this. And straightway he preached Christ in the synagogues, that he is the Son of God. But all that heard him were amazed and said, Is not this he that destroyed them, which called on this name in Jerusalem? And he came here for that intent, that he might bring them bound unto the chief priest. Verse 22. But Saul increased the more in strength, and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus, proving that this is the very Christ. I'm talking about the Apostle Paul that used to persecute Christians, kill Christians, and now, because of a change by a man called Jesus, now he's preaching about the cross, preaching about the Son of God, and he now is trying to convince people that there has been a change because of Jesus. And I understand these people, the crowd came and said, you know what, this is a trick. He's going to try to corral us, and all of a sudden, then everybody else is going to come and kill us. But he was preaching, trying to convince the people that there was a change in his life. What I'm trying to tell you this morning, when there is a change in your life, in your old friends, let me tell you something. I'm doing a revival next year in my hometown in Plant City, Florida. And I even had some of my friends inbox me and say, Jeff, I just saw you're going to do a revival. Are you a preacher? I'm like, yeah. God called me 27 years ago. No lie. They're like, really? And then another friend said, Jeff, I know you. And I said, no, you knew me. See, you knew me. See, now I have to convince them. Because they only knew the old Jeff. So when the new Jeff steps in, I got to convince them that there's been a change in my life. Come on. Amen. See, the thing is, I still drink. To be honest with you, I still drink. I just change fountains. Do you understand? I was a hellion. I was a rebel. I'm telling you, thank God for the prayers of mamas. But I have to understand one thing, that they're not where I am now and I'm not where they are. But I'm going to have to convince them that Jesus Christ changed my life. That's the, I could take my baby to a nice restaurant and buddy, the candle lights and the china, and we'll walk in, the lights are dim, and man, it just looks so romantic, and we'll walk up to the table and the cloth is over it and the china and the glasses and the candle and the arrangement, and I'll pull her chair back and she'll sit down, and then I'll go around and pull up and sit down and look at her eyes going, man, you have beautiful eyes. But we can sit there as long as we want till they throw us out. And look at each other and look at each other and look at each other. But nothing will happen in the restaurant until the cook shows up. See, you could just go to church, but until the cook shows up, you're just going to sit there. See, there has to be a convincing attitude when you leave this house today. If you go to the restaurant, let the waitress or waiter know, boy, you've been the touch. You've been more than touch. That's how I call it down there, touch. You've been to Christ. We have to convince people that we believe in a God that is not dead, but he's alive. I don't understand. You can look, matter of fact, I told a church a while back, if you love Jesus, notify your face. No lie. I know I'm not going back, but only how you can make some people smile is turn them upside down. You know, the front, you'll get that tomorrow by slow freight. But we have to convince this world that there is something different in our life. So what happens when Christ changed your life? There's a change. There's a convincing attitude. Matter of fact, let me just stop there and share this. At our house, years ago, I was in the living room. It was on a Saturday. Jasmine had a friend over. I was watching the godly program, ESPN, and I was sitting there watching a ball game. All of a sudden, my little girl back in the day, I guess she's always going to be my little girl, but a few years back, she came in, her and her friend, said, "Dad, there's a snake on the driveway. There's a snake." Now, they get me all the time. And I'm like, "Jazz, whatever, y'all just go. I'm watching a ball game, go." She came back again. She said, "Dad, there's a snake on the driveway. Come on." I knew they were going to scare me. I knew they do that all the time. So about the third time, Jasmine and Shay came running in. They literally got in front of me. And they said, "Daddy, there is a snake going in the garage. Come on." So you know what? I got up. You say, "Well, Pastor Jeff, why did you get up on the third time?" Because I could see the look on her face that convinced me that the snake was real. Even by the look on our life can save a lost man or a lost woman. You say, "Pastor, what did you do to the snake?" In the name of Jesus, if I'm lying, I'm dying. I went and got my hoe. I chopped his head off. I got my 12 gauge and put five. Didn't I not? I literally shot. I hate snake. I hate. You say, "Five shells." I took the plug out. I have five. I carry a gun just in case my angels are on coffee break. I carry it. That's okay. All right, y'all, listen. Well, I don't know about y'all. I'm having a good time. You say, "Well, this is just like a comedy central around here." See, that's the problem. Some of you are so stiff-necked and religious, you can't laugh. See, when there's a change in your life, everything changes. I'm just telling you the truth. The world's not going to have all the fun. I'm just preaching truth today. See, there's a change. There's a convincing attitude. Number three, there is a continual praise. I said there is a continual praise. The Bible says in Psalm chapter 149, beginning with verse 1, it says, "Praise thee, the Lord. Sing unto the Lord a new song, and his praise in the congregation of saints. Let Israel rejoice in him that made him. Let the children of Zion be joyful in their king. Let them praise his name in the dance." In the dance. "Let them sing praises unto him with the timbrel and harp. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He will beautify the meek with salvation. Let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds." So mom and dad, if your kids are jumping on their bed, as long as they're singing worship songs, you can't discipline because it says to worship, jump on your bed. I'm just saying. Kids, that's your free one right there. Verse 6 says, "Let the high praises of God be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hand." Psalm chapter 113, verse 3, "From the rising of the sun unto the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised." I don't understand why any Christian doesn't take time to worship. I know when somebody's in revival, it's because they worship more, not just on Sundays and Wednesdays. See, a lot of us show up today, "All right, I get my worship on." No, we got to put it on every day. See, some people, I'm telling you, some people, I've been there. I pastored some churches. I had a deacon come to me and say, "Pastor, I love you, but it's getting a little out of control. It might just get out of our hands." I'm praying it will. We've messed it up so much. He is worthy. He is worthy to be praised. You say, well, Pastor Jeff, I love you, but Jesus never ran down the aisles and jumped in the pews and swung from the chandeliers. No, he probably didn't, but everybody he touched did. Everybody he touched did. See, I can't help it. Whether anybody likes me or not, I'm not here to make friends. Man, Jesus saved me. He's touched me. He's changed me. I'm not here to impress people. I'm not here to make you happy. Because listen, I was on my way to hell. I was a no good young man that had a godly mom and a godly daddy that didn't give a rip. But there's a man that came by on interstate and stopped my car. And he's changed me. See, I get excited, whether you sit there or not. I get excited because A, he's the Alpha. B, because he lives. C, he's my conqueror. D, he's my deliverer. E, he's eternal. F, he lives forever. G, he's my God. H, he's the high priest. I, he's the great I am. J, he's my Jesus. K, he's the King of kings. L, he's the Lord of lords. M, he's my master. N, he's never ending. O, he was my opportunity and I accepted him. P, he's the Prince of Peace. Q, he can answer any question that you give him. R, he is the resurrection. S, he is my Savior. T, he's the time of my life. U, he is the universe. V, he is my victory. W, he can withstand anything that you give him. X, except a man be born again, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Why? Because he can be yours. Not if the price is right. The price has already been paid. And Z, even old Zacchaeus got saved. That's what he means to me. So don't tell me to back down. Don't tell me to hush up. No man intimidates how I worship. No man directs my steps. God has already ordered and directed them. See, I got praise in me. Come on, somebody. See, until you understand my pain, you'll never understand my praise. Until you go through the pig pen, you really cannot worship right. Until you go through the pig pen, you can't see right. Until you go through the pig pen, you really cannot serve right or even testify right. See, I don't understand what the uproar about all this worship and all the controversy going on and this is wrong and that's right and this is... Listen, long as it's about Jesus. I mean, we have radical Islam. We have terrorists, rather they want to call them terrorists, they're terrorists. And they are willing to die for their faith. And we have some spineless, backbone church folk that's like, well, it's just not me. God's not so concerned if you'll die for him. He's just concerned who will live for him. See, nothing hurts my feelings. I've been spit on. I've been hit. I've been cussed. I've done it all. Literally been thrown out of a church. Literally. Literally. You hadn't stopped me. It hadn't stopped me. It just made me stronger. Because I don't give a rip. There ain't no man on this earth going to stop my praise. I am radical. I am a radical American Christian that thanks God for every soldier, American soldier. I thank God for a man called Jesus, where both of them gave their blood for salvation and for our freedom. Yes, No, I'm just telling you. The bullying is enough. It's time to stop. You say, well, Pastor, how will awakening come? When Christians stand up and draw a line in the sand and stand on one side or the other. I'm just saying. You say, well, Pastor, I'm just comfortable like I am. Don't get around me. Comfort's too long, too much. He is worthy to be praised. So what happens when Christ changes your life? There's a change. There's a convincing attitude. There's a continual praise. Number four, there's a caring spirit. A caring spirit. The Bible says in Mark chapter 2, beginning with verse 1, and again he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noised that he was in the house. Every time I read that, it makes me want to have a spell. He was in the house. I don't know why he was in the house. And straightway, many were gathered together, insomuch that there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door. And he preached the word unto them. And they came, and they came unto him, bringing one of the sick of palsy, which was born afore. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. And when Jesus saw their faith, their caring spirit, he said unto the sick of the palsy, son, thy sins be forgiven. But there was a certain of the scribes sitting there. There's always somebody. Maybe this is my one shot. You say, well, Pastor, I don't like you already. I don't like you either. Really, honest, I'm not trying to be all arrogant and confident and funny. I don't try to be funny. I'm just, this is how God created me. This is my personality. I'm not changing. I love this. I can tell. Everybody's smiling. Everybody's good. I can tell. Some of you just, like, they wasn't smiling. Now they, yeah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm just sick of plastic folk. I need to come back for about a week. Verse 6, but there was a certain of the scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, why does this man speak blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God only? And immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they so reasoned with themselves, he said unto them, why reason these things in your hearts? Whether it is easier to say to the sick of the palsy, thy sins be forgiven, or say, arise and take up your bed and walk. These four men got the job done because they cared for a friend. And I love using illustrations, real personal illustrations. But we have all kind of folk where I pastor. A while back, we had a prostitute walk in. And I've taught my people, finally, they're getting it, that when she walked in, natty hair, you can just tell the drugs in her face, dented in, short skirt, little old shirt. I can honestly and proudly say, if some of my folk are watching, you know it's true. Nobody turned their head and said, oh, my God. Look who just, oh, my God, who is that? They were fighting each other to get to her first. You know why? I've taught my sheep. That could be our daughter. That could be our son that walks into a church in Virginia or in New York or Alabama or Florida or whatever. I would want a spirit-filled, nice people. To embrace my daughter and keep her safe and love on her. I got to speak truth, church. I understand why a lot of this generation don't want to come. Because we have a lot of judgmental folk. I'm just shooting y'all straight. Well, it's not the same like it used to. No, it's not. The world's not. I told the men yesterday, this generation, not all of them, but a lot in this generation, they don't understand honor anymore or respect to the elders. I was taught yes, sir, and no, sir. And my kids were. But not all kids are. So when they come, man, they're coming to a place where people's loving on them. And if we, as the church, doesn't love them, somebody else will. Can I get a witness in here? That's the truth. We have to have a caring spirit. We have to love people. Not when they get cleaned up. We help them clean up. If they need a new pair of shoes, take up a love offering and buy them a new pair of shoes. That's what we did. We bought a man that always wanted a suit. And this was the big joke yesterday because I've only had two suits when I first got in the ministry. And all these other pastors were wearing these nice $500 suits. And I had a lime green and a beige. No, it was puke ugly. It was nasty. But I just changed my ties with the same shirt. And it was like I had four suits. But I said one day with hard work, I'm going to wear me a nice suit. And I have 50 suits. And I look good today. Matter of fact, I'll be honest with y'all. I like in red. But there was a pastor that we went out because he's always dreamed of having a nice suit. I've been there. I'll be 49 years old in July, 26 years in ministry. I understand. And my heart went out to this pastor because I saw him in me or me in him years ago. So Becky and I went out and bought him not one suit, but two. No, not for our glory. No. But where I live, there's a store called K&G. You can get two suits for $150. They look like $1 million, but two of them. But we fixed it up, ties and shirts. We gave it to him. It was like he won the lottery. He was so proud. That's why our team at the church won't let me be on the benevolence team, because I'll give everything away. But there's people that will come in these doors next Sunday and the next Sunday and a year from now. They won't remember what you sung. They won't remember the sermon. But they'll remember that hug, that love. We as children of God in the church, we have to continue and get back of lifting each other up and not keep shooting the wounded. We lived in Atlanta years ago. And if you'll look in Webster's dictionary under construction, it'll say Atlanta, Georgia. But the house that we moved into, my beautiful, wonderful, awesome wife wanted all white carpet. I'm talking about white as your sweater back there. White. With a 3 and 4 year old. And Georgia Clay. Now, I'm not lying, it's the truth. But I knew if I wanted something to eat, oh, baby, yeah, we gonna do it. No problem. Well, in our home, true story, in our home, we had a rule. No chocolate milk, no sweet tea. At that time, no Dr. Pepper can come out, or coffee can come out of the kitchen. You say, Pastor, boy, y'all mean. Well, don't come visit us. That's our rule. I'm paying for it. Stay home. So I remember coming in from a meeting, and you went, I think it was Hampton, Virginia, for 3 days. Virginia. So for 3 days, I was being a mom, dad, Mr. Dishwasher, Mr. Cook, everything. And I don't know about you, but how many parents do we have in the house? How many parents? Come on, be honest. Some of you are like, well, okay, your kids are not in here. Go ahead. You know everything is okay when your kids are fussing and fighting and screaming. It's when they become quiet, you know you're in trouble. Is that the truth? See, I got an amen. Some of you, I thought you'd been dead sitting there with your eyes open all morning. And you're like, hallelujah. Amen. You just received your prayer language. See there? There you go. I felt it. But anyway, as long as they're but yelling, screaming, it's okay. But it's when they got quiet. And I'm not trying to be funny again. I'm sorry. But halftime was almost here. So I said, when halftime gets here, I'll get up and go check on my kids. Halftime came. I got up. I walked to Jasmine's room and looked in there. Nobody was there. I went to Jockton's room that was right next door, and I stuck my head in there in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Jasmine is standing about this tall, standing in the corner just like this. And I looked to my right. There was Jockton. We call him Jock. He brought and snuck his chocolate milk sippy cup past me. And the top came off somehow and spilled. And even the quick in the bottom of it was seeping out. It was all over the carpet. And he had 2 towels, 4 washcloths. No lie. A roll of toilet paper, paper towels, everything. And the godly daddy that I am, really, godly dad, I looked down at my son and I said, Jock, what have you done, son? Both of us are going to be in trouble. I did. Then I took care of business. See, my daddy, he believed in time out growing up. My dad did. He took time out of his busy schedule and whooped me. That was his time out. And I'm okay. I'm okay. I hadn't been on Dr. Phil or Oprah. I'm okay. That's what we need to bring back in this nation. I'm just saying. That's all I'm saying. I'm not talking about beatings. I'm talking about whoopings. I'm talking about discipline. That's another teaching. But anyway, after I took care of business, I went to the kitchen. Got some of this carpet stuff. I was like, where are you going, girl? I was like, she didn't like it. She's leaving. But I got some of the stuff. I don't know what you call it, but I got it up. I mean, I got it up off the carpet. And all of a sudden, I stood up. Little Joshua Jockton literally was like this in his diapers. He was looking like this. I said, what? He said, Daddy. I said, yeah. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. And all of a sudden, that fast, the Holy Spirit spoke and said, Jeff Smith, that's the same way that I am. That's the same way that my Heavenly Father is. That when we make a mess of our life, stains, wounds, cut, hurts, all of that mud, all of that filth, it's the same way that God sent His Son to come help us clean our mess up. And you know what? I got all of that out. And it's the same way through the blood of Jesus. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing more, nothing less than the blood of Jesus. What can take the old alcoholic out of alcoholism? Nothing more, nothing less than the blood of Jesus. What can take an old drug addict out of drug addiction? Nothing more, nothing less than the blood of Jesus. So in my life and my sins, Father, I am so sorry. And every time I say that, He comes and He helps me clean my mess up. That's the God we serve. So when Christ changes your life, when Christ changes your life, there should have been a change. There should have been a convincing attitude of your friends, a continual praise and a caring spirit. All I know is Jesus changes people. And all God's people said, amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I thank you for your patience. I thank you for listening to the word. With every head bowed, every eye closed, I just want to ask you a personal question. If you truly, and it's just my heart to yours, if your heart would quit beating right now, don't answer out loud. If your heart would quit beating right now, would you spend eternity in heaven or hell? And right now, some of you are saying, Pastor Jeff, I hope I'd go to heaven. I think I would. Please understand, please. It's not a hope-so salvation. It's not a think-so salvation. It's a know-so. You say, well, Pastor Jeff, I'm close. I'm 99% sure that I'm saved. Listen to me. 99% saved will make you 100% lost. It's 100% or it's nothing. You say, well, Pastor Jeff, my mama said that I got saved during revival. My daddy said I was saved during this meeting or at... Listen to me, please don't let this offend you, get mad at me. But your mama don't know. Your daddy don't know. Only you and God knows, genuinely. Just because I go in my garage when I get home and I stand there doesn't mean that I'm going to turn into a car. Just because we come to the house of God doesn't mean that we have eternal salvation or we are saved. Because just like you, we know a lot of good church members, church people. But a lot of church people are lost. Examine your heart. You say, Pastor Jeff, thank you for the truth. I need to know today. I need to know right now. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If that is you right now, deep within your heart, just say, Dear Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Forgive me of my past. And dear Jesus, right now, I am asking you to come into my heart and save me. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving my soul. Now I know Every head bowed, every eye closed. Nobody will come to you. Nobody will embarrass you. I will not call you out. But between me, you, and God, who would have enough courage between me, you, and God with nobody looking, saying, Pastor Jeff, I prayed that prayer and I meant it by holding up your hands, slipping up your hands and putting it right back down. Just slip it up, put it right back down. Slip it up, put it right back down. God bless you. 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 Now listen, we're right on time. We're right there. This is what I want to do before, and I know it may be different. It's even different from me. But I'm going to be honest with you. I do not believe in camouflage Christianity. I believe if you truly meant that prayer and you asked Jesus Christ to take up residence in your life, that you are not ashamed. Because if we deny Him before men, He will deny us for the Father. But with nobody looking, and you may just have to say, excuse me, but I want you to show everybody that you have enough courage and you don't give a rip what anybody may say. But I want the ones of you that truly prayed that prayer with me a minute ago, you raised your hands or you didn't raise your hands, I want you to get out of your seat and walk and stand right in front of this pulpit right now. I want you to get up and come. If you truly meant it, I want you to come on right now. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. That you truly meant it. Come on. That's right. That's right. That's right. Yes. 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 Yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's right. That's right. That's what I'm talking about. Yeah. Hallelujah. 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 Today's a brand new day for the rest of your life. Brand new day. And see, a lot of people say, well, the devil's making me doubt my salvation. No, 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 no. That's so untrue. Why would the devil make you doubt your salvation? Because if he made you doubt, what would you do? Get saved. You're saved or you're not. Somebody say, well, I thought you were already saved. Nobody knows. But you truly. Thank God for the men and women and young ladies today that said, you know what? I don't care. I'm coming and showing the whole world that Jesus Christ changed my life. I just wanted you to have enough boldness to stand up. I wanted you to have enough courage to say, you know what? I'm not ashamed. It's a brand new day for you for the rest of your life. Brand new. That baggage that you've been carrying, all that worry right now, you're going through some junk. You are. Don't let the lie of the devil keep planting in your mind of that guilt. You let it go. I release that guilt right now in your life in the name of Jesus. Release it. That the words in your past, don't believe it. God loves you and He has a plan for you and a purpose, but you release it. Pastor Bob, if you could come and however you do it, I want to go another step and minister to these folks. Can we all stand to our feet? Everyone stand. The second thing I want to do, and I'm done. When I say I'm done, I go sit down. You say, well, Pastor, why don't you do that? Well, just like y'all, I have a decision team that they pray with people because I have to be in the spirit and listen what direction to go. But there's some time that man messes up the spirit where I just get out of the way. Are y'all with me? But can I just speak to y'all before we leave? Did the Holy Spirit speak to anybody during this message where we could do better somehow, some way? Maybe some of your mom and dads, you have daughters that's out in left field. I want to ask you to come to this altar and pray. You know what happened a month ago? I'm not going to say the name. We had a 13-year-old girl come because in my spirit, I knew somebody was battling suicide. This little girl comes from a prominent family. They prayed over her because of suicide. This family got upset and left. You know why? Image. I don't give a rip if my son or daughter, they came for suicide and I had godly women and men praying over to save their life. I throw image out of the house. That's what I'm saying, man. We get so dignified. This is ministry. But some of you need to come because his presence here. Join hands with somebody to come and pray for your daughter or your son or the behalf of somebody. Maybe somebody just, you're tired and you're weary. Come and just say, God, fill me up. I need strength. Until the church throws away pride, that stinking pride, and just come and collapse in his presence. Say, God, I need you.
Hallelujah.
I need you.
Oh, we need you, Lord. We need you. We need you, Lord.
A marriage or a co-worker.
Everywhere, everywhere.
Church, in the name of Jesus.